Hope Hicks is back here in Washington from her new job and her new life out on the West Coast. And that separation from Trump world is changing what was once constant interaction with the president and with his inner circle. CNN's Caitlin Collins has some inside reporting on the big change. Caitlin, what do you know?
Well, John, we're essentially seeing that Hope Hicks is returning to a different Washington with Democrats now in charge of the House, but also 15 months later after she left the White House as a communications director, we're learning about a very dramatic shift in her relationship with the president himself, someone who our sources said she was in near constant conversation with, not only when he was in office, but also on the campaign trail. But now that she has moved to the West Coast, she has this new job at Fox, we're told that she and the president rarely speak anymore. They went through this period after she left the White House where she had moved to New York, was trying to live a little bit of a quieter life. But when she moved across the United States, essentially the distance between the two of them grew and they stopped speaking nearly as often as they had before. When Hope Hicks, when she worked at the White House, would not often leave the White House because she always wanted to be within earshot of Trump. Now we're told that sometime last year, she stopped returning several of the president's calls, leading the president to ask people what happened to Hope. Now, John, to be clear, we're told that this doesn't signify any change in the way Hope feels toward the president. We're told that she's still on his side, still supports him. But it does give you some revealing aspects of someone that the president used to speak with so often. And that is why Democrats wanted to get her in front of them today, because they know not only was she his most trusted confidant, but also she was there every step of the way for several key events that they want to probe. But we're seeing just how things have changed between her and the president now that she's back here in Washington.
Caitlin Collins live at the White House, and as Caitlin was reporting, you saw the scrum there on Capitol Hill. Hope Hicks apparently leaving the committee room. We'll see if that's just a lunch break or what it is. We'll keep track of that. Caitlin, thank you for that. There we see we'll keep these pictures up as she walks down the hall. Let's listen for a minute.
Why not answer the committee's questions, Ms.
Hicks and her lawyers making their way down the hall there, making their way into, it looks like, another holding room there. We'll see if the committee continues. It's probably a lunch break here. We shall keep track of that. With me in studio to share their reporting and their insights, Sungmin Kim of the Washington Post, Michael Scherer of the New York Times, CNN's Jeff Zeleny, and Vivian Salama of the Wall Street Journal. There is no one, at least candidate Trump, early days of President Trump, there was no one who had as much access, as much proximity, that he relied on as much just to bounce ideas off, to talk to. What is the significance of Hope Hicks talking to House Democrats? Are they cleaning this up, or they expect something new?
I think it is incredibly significant that she's even there. I mean, to think back during the campaign, as Mike knows very well, she ironed his pants. She created his messages. I don't mean anything odd by that, but that's how close she was to him. She was like the closest staffer potentially to him. That continued into the White House. They clearly were trying to find some new information from her time at the White House. She's not saying anything about that, as Monty was saying, but there are things that she saw during the campaign and the transition, particularly that Trump Tower meeting, back to June of 2016. Very surprised if she would say anything new or damaging about the president, but she clearly wants to cooperate there. You saw the smile on her face. That's how we often saw her at the White House, very pleasing and accommodating, but protective of her boss, President Trump, and I think she still is, regardless of how much she talks to him.
And he clearly is paying attention as you continue the conversation. He tweeting this morning, the Dems are unhappy with the Mueller report, so after almost 3 years, they want a redo, a do-over, and in the middle of that, yet now they bring back Hope Hicks. Why aren't the Dems looking at the 33,000 emails? Familiar there. Rigged hearings, a disgrace to our country. The president has said several times over the last couple of years, when Hope Hicks has been in the news, when there has been something about her, that is when we see him get more angry, more interested.
Well, part of the thing about Hope Hicks is the informality of her relationship with the president, right? There's so many of the other people in the White House. If you're a White House counsel, if you're a somebody that's got an official position, a cabinet secretary, you interact with the president in a very formalized way. I mean, less so in this administration than maybe in previous ones, but still, you've got a sort of structure on your relationship with the president. That wasn't the case with Hope. Hope was there interacting with him in such an informal kind of way, just kind of stream of consciousness at all times. The proximity, the funny thing about her not describing where her office was is that her office was so close, in proximity to him, and that actually has some meaning in the White House. The sort of where you are physically located matters. And I think, the idea that the Democrats had was that they could you know, potentially get information that they couldn't get from people in a more structured way.
And the question is, can they get more from her, or do they just want to corroborate things she told Robert Mueller? Here's something from the Mueller report, pages 105 and 106, one of the 10 obstructive acts Mueller lays out for Democrats to consider. On at least three occasions, between June 29, 2017 and July 9, 2017, the president directed Hicks and others not to publicly disclose information about the June 9, 2016 meeting between senior campaign officials and a Russian attorney. On June 29, Hicks warned the president that the emails setting up the June 9th meeting were really bad and that the story would be massive when it broke. But the president told her and Kushner, quote, leave it alone. So she is central to one of the 10 counts that Robert Mueller said, not my decision to make, but if you wanted to make an obstruction case, here's a roadmap.
She's definitely central, but her being in front of the committee today is also a reminder that while it is a major coup just to simply have her show up, just how far House Democrats have to go in investigating aspects of the Mueller report, aspects of the obstruction of justice, and so many other things about this administration, because she is not answering any questions about her time in the administration. The House Judiciary Committee has struggled to get Don McGahn before the committee. Other committees have had so many struggles securing, for example, the tax returns. So there is going to be a point where House Democrats will really reach their boiling point and say, all right, we are moving forward with impeachment proceedings. Nancy Pelosi is clearly trying to control that, but you're seeing some of that anger come from House Democrats about Hope's unwillingness to answer questions about her time in the
administration. Just the part that they had to agree to do this behind closed doors. If you're the House Democrats, she's the former White House Communications Director, somebody who was at the president's side throughout the campaign, throughout the days in question during the presidency early on. You want her on camera. You want her answering questions. What do you know about the Trump Tower meeting? Did the president tell his son to lie about the Trump Tower meeting? What do you know about the payments to Stormy Daniels and Kara McDougal? They wanted all that on camera. The only way she would come in is if they agreed to let her come in behind closed doors.
And remember that the president is someone who, even in his previous life as a businessman, used non-disclosure agreements for his dealings with most of his staff. And so this is a very sensitive thing for him because he knows that Hope Hicks had access that most people did not. And the fear for him and the anxiety for him is that she would go out and be compelled to somehow reveal things about him that he doesn't want out there. But the bigger picture also is that the president has other issues with this and with Congress particularly, where he's been angry since the start about them undermining his authority in general. And so you have this issue of executive privilege, where the president believes that he can ask these people not to comply with any subpoenas or any orders to testify. But actually, from a legal perspective, there isn't that much precedent on this, and especially when you're dealing with someone who's now a private citizen, like Hope Hicks, like Don McGahn, the former White House counsel, all of them now in their capacity as private citizens, there really isn't that much precedent as far as what the executive branch policy requires. And so that's where a lot of this turmoil and a lot of this debate comes.
And this debate may continue in the courts for several years as the Democrats press their cases, their appeals and the like, and the lines of privilege could be redrawn or at least clarified from that.